down in Laura, so they're not yours.
Oh, thank you very much.
Do we need tablets for this?
I would say towards the end at the Q&A part, and kind of looking at your own individual ones, that'll be helpful. Otherwise, however you normally take notes will be fine. If that's pen and paper, that's totally fine.
I already did it, yeah, I know. I don't know.
All right, it's just a minute after 2 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get started and get all the important cool stuff out of the way first. That way the folks that got here on time will actually benefit for being on time. And the folks that come in late will miss all the cool stuff. How's that?
Yeah, that's right.
No, actually, what I want to kind of do is go over the top five reasons why this KW website platform, the new KW websites, are very important to you and your business, and why you're going to really love them. And that's what we're going to be talking about over the course of the next probably 60 to 75 minutes or so. And we're going to leave plenty of time for question and answers at the end. So these are the top five reasons up here. Probably the biggest change that you all will notice is that they look a whole lot better than e-agency. Have you all used your e-agency websites before? Who's used the e-agency ones? A couple of you. How about the Market Leader ones, the e-edge websites? Okay, these look a whole lot better. They look modern. It's a kind of a clean, new look and feel, and they look really, really great. They're also what's called responsive. And what that means is that you can actually view them on any size device, and it's going to look great. And when I say device, I'm talking about a widescreen TV like what we're looking at here, down to your laptop screen, to a tablet, regardless of which way it's turned, down to a phone, regardless of which way it's turned. So responsive doesn't just mean that it's going to look great on mobile, it means it's going to look great on all devices, including those widescreen displays. It's very easy for you to manage your content, which we'll be talking a lot about today, which makes it then very search engine friendly. Does anybody here want to be found online?
Yes.
Leads? All right. So this platform makes it a lot easier on you and a lot easier for you to be found inside of the search engine. So that's what we mean when we say search engine friendly. And then finally, these pieces are all connected to your existing Keller Williams technology. So it's not like you have to go out and buy a third-party tool or website in order for you to be able to benefit from that. So that's what we're going to be covering today, and we're going to be covering that in a lot of details. A lot of folks wonder who I am and why I'm here. First of all, my name is Ken Granger, and I'm actually the founder of Brandco, which is a Keller Williams approved vendor, and the only Playster approved, or only Keller Williams vendor that's Playster certified partner as well. I actually sat on the Agent Technology Council at Keller Williams Realty from 2008 till 2013, and I'm the Market Center Tech Coordinator for over a dozen offices across the country. So pretty well ingrained in Keller Williams technology, and for about 5 years I was a director of Keller Williams, or technology for the North Florida region. So I have a lot of Keller Williams experience and a lot of tech experience as well. Okay? So before we get too deep into the content of what we're going to be talking about today, I'd like to ask you a question, which we do in the start of all of these classes, and big webinars as well, and that's why. Why do you want to have a good website? So I want you to think about that for a minute. Because every time we start thinking about, we were talking earlier about widgets and all this other kind of stuff, every time you think about something new to your website, I want to reference back to this moment and the why. Does anybody want to care to share with me why they want to have a website? Yeah?
It's the professionalism that
they
want to portray.
Okay, so to portray professionalism,
mm-hmm.
to whom?
To the client.
Okay, to potential clients. Great, absolutely. Anyone else?
It's the first step that people go to now.
Right, so your people are starting online to start their home search, so you want to be there, right? So would you say you want to get found online?
Absolutely.
Okay, great. Anyone else? So we usually hear three things. The number one thing is leads.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else feel that way? They want leads?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's worth it?
Yeah.
Number one is leads. Number two, just like you said, is kind of professionalism and kind of to look the part, right? In fact, 44-ish% of the people say that they want to have good lead generation on their website, and then closely followed thereafter, about 39%, they want to build their brand and credibility. They want to look professional online. And everything else in between is great, but those two things account for about 80% of the response when we ask why you want to have a good website. So every time we talk about something in this class today, and from every day this point forward, I want you to think back to this moment. Why? And if it doesn't yield your why, if it doesn't help your why, if it doesn't help you get better leads or make you look more professional, you should probably not invest any time in it. We hear so many agents that get caught up in all the bells and whistles and cool things that you can do online, and they end up spinning their wheels, and they don't end up with better leads because of it. And sometimes a lot of things that you could do to your website will actually hurt your lead capture. Do you guys remember when you used to go to a website and there was like this landing page where the doors would open and you can like walk up a spiral staircase? Have you seen those websites?
No.
Good. They were terrible for your brand. They were terrible for lead capture. It caused people to click the back button. Okay? So they were really, really bad, but real estate agents loved it because they thought it looked professional in this grand foyer as you walk in there, and it was just this great experience. It looked great visually, but from an SEO perspective and from a visitor's perspective, it was horrible. Has anybody been on a site where there's music that...
What happens?
You turn it off.
You turn it off? How do you turn it off?
Go on. I have to look for the little button.
You are a very patient woman. I love you, Red.
you bounce out of there.
A lot of people will just instantly close it out, especially if they're not supposed to be on a website, right? If they're at work and all of a sudden they browse to somewhere and this music comes blaring out at them, right? The typical behavior is not patience. You're beautiful for doing that. But the typical behavior is for them just to click the X right away, okay? And that goes for people that play videos, too. So it's very well known that you probably shouldn't do that with music, but a lot of people have their videos play right away when people get to their website. So these are things that you should be thinking about. What's going to be the repercussions of doing these things? And always come back to this why. So I want to kind of go through this story of lead generation and how lead generation works online from the moment that you get found all the way up to the point where you all collect a commission. And there's 8 steps here. First of all, if you're expecting to get leads online, you have to get found somehow. And typically that's through what we call SEO, which is search engine optimization. So if I were to go to Google and type something in, what would you type if you were a consumer trying to buy a house around Naperville? What would you type in?
Houses for sale
in Naperville, right? Okay, so that's the idea of getting found. Anybody want to get found for houses for sale in Naperville? Or Downhurst, there's some Downhurst
sure.
Homes here. Yeah, right? So that's the idea of SEO here. Now, once they find you on Google, it's really important that you get them to click on your website. There's other websites there. We want them to click on ours. Okay? Once we get them there, we do not want to have anything that's going to get them away from there. So we don't want to link them over to our social media profile right away. A lot of agents want their Facebook right there. Well, we're trying to lead capture. Why would we take them away from Facebook, or away from your website over to Facebook? So keeping them there and getting them to stick on your website is really, really important, right? And then we have to give them a way to lead capture. A form, home value, schedule an appointment, how much is my home worth, those types of things. Some reason for them to give you their contact information, something of value so that they'll give you good contact information, right? And then, this is the exciting part for most real estate agents, you get the appointment, you write the contract, you do the closing, and ultimately it yields commission. Would you agree that this is kind of the workflow of how that works?
Yeah.
Well, here's the problem. Most real estate agents don't want to do the top part of that. They want to do the bottom part of this. Right? That's what you went to real estate school for. You didn't go to real estate school because you wanted to do SEO or that you wanted to, you know, do lead capture forms on your website. You went to real estate school because you like showing properties and helping people buy a home. So there's a disconnect here, and that's what we're going to talk about today. How you can be better above the line. I can't help you writing contracts. Certainly you do not want me advising you on that. But everything above the line that I can help you with. All right, you guys along for that journey?
You bet.
All right, cool. So before we get too deep into the technology that you have available to you now, I want to talk to you why this is important to be looking at today. And that is some of your existing technology is going to be phased out. The e-agency website platform is going to be phased out later this year. They're saying late 2016. We don't know what that means. December 31st, probably the best guess that they're going to phase it out towards the end of the year. But that could be any time in the last quarter of this year. Your current e-agency website will go away. Now, when I looked at your Market Center website, over 150 of you have your e-agency website there. So it's really important that everybody kind of circulates through and starts to move away from the e-agency site. You're welcome. The eEdge and Market Leader platform is not going anywhere soon. However, Chris did kind of tease or hint from stage at Family Reunion that they are working on a new CRM solution, a new customer relationship management solution, a new version of eEdge, essentially. They hinted at that, but they didn't put any dates on that other than They're going to be beta testing it later this year. Okay? So that's why there's some urgency and why this is important that everybody's paying attention to this move, because there are going to be things that are going to be phased out here quite soon. All right? Now, before we go into details, anybody have any questions now?
What's going to happen with the information that's in the agency?
So the e-agency website content will not be transferred over to your Playster website. So if you've created custom pages inside of e-agency, you would be responsible for copying and pasting those pages over into the new Playster website. Okay? Nothing will transfer automatically. On the CRM side of things, that's a different story. I can't imagine that they would make us do that. But on the website, they are doing that. That's a good time for housekeeping, too, because a lot of people's e-agency website doesn't have good stuff in it. They typically have the buyer's resources and seller's resources page, that stock content that Keller Williams put in there. That's not really worth it to transfer over. So it's a good time for some spring cleaning. Look around and see what really needs to come over from your agency to Playster. That's a really good question. Any other questions here?
Yeah. You were saying that most of us have our e-agency website on the Market Leader website.
On the Market Center website.
Market Center website.
Yeah, if I said Market Leader, I may have missed.
Okay,
misspoke.
No, you might have said Market Center website,
okay.
But I didn't knowingly do that.
Okay.
So,
how or why?
How did that happen?
I'll show you.
And how do I undo it?
I'll show you. That's really important today. One of the things that we're going to be talking about is that get found piece, and that a lot of that has to do with the search engine optimization. We're going to talk in a minute about your Market Center website and some of the other websites that people could potentially find you on, and making sure that you have your profile exactly the way it needs to be, so you look your best and have the best opportunity of getting found. So we'll go into that in that very topic in detail. Okay? Any other questions before we go in? We're going to talk about how this new website plugs into the current ecosystem. We talked about leads. This is what we have before the new KW website came out. We had our e-agency website, and then we had our Market Leader website. Some people call it the e-edge website. And both of those would feed into the e-edge transaction management system. Now, e-edge is the entire thing. It's the dot loop part of it. It's the entire thing. And the website was a single piece, as well as the agency website was a single piece that fed leads into the e-edge. Okay? Right now, since the Playster websites have rolled out, the new KW websites, there are now three websites out there potentially for you. Okay? We used to do a class that was called Why Do I Have Two Websites? We don't really want to have a class Why Do I Have Three Websites, because one's going to be phased out. But basically, you have your agency, your new KW website that's powered by Playster, and your Market Leader website, all now funneling leads into eEdge. So regardless of where that lead comes from, it will show up in your eEdge My Transactions dashboard. All right, so it doesn't matter where the source is. And there technically is another little extension over there, and that's the mobile app as well. If something comes in from the mobile app, it will also show up in your eEdge. Okay. Any questions on this? Pretty straightforward. Now, if down the road they, you know, kind of put something new in here, the funnel will still be the same. All of those sources are going to go into your CRM, whether that's with Market Leader or whoever it happens to be. So I think what we should do now is go live and take a look at what we were talking about just a minute ago, and that's getting found online, getting found in your office. And the best way for me to do that is just to go into the office website and take a look around. Now, because this is your real office, and we're looking at real agents, I want to make sure that we mark this room as a safe zone. If I happen to pull up your website, please don't be embarrassed or shy or go running out of the room screaming and crying. We're just trying to help everyone get an idea of how things are set up correct or maybe incorrect. All right, do I have your commitment with that? Okay. So one of the ways that people would get to your office website, there's really two types of people that come to this website. Number one is consumers, buyers or sellers. And number two, does anybody know what number two is? The type of person that would come here?
Other agents?
Other agents from another market, okay? Those are the two behavior profiles that come to this office website. Either a consumer or an agent from another market. Now, if it's an agent from another market, it's typically a Keller Williams agent, right? And what are they looking to do?
Referral.
Place a referral. So I want you to think about that behavior type right there. The real estate agent from another Keller Williams office looking to place a referral here. Has anybody done that before?
Yes.
A couple times? A couple of you? All right. So typically what you would do is you'd come in here and you would just basically say that you want to find an agent. And I don't really know who I'm looking for. I don't know that I'm looking for K Ken Smith or Michelle or anyone. So I could click here and view all agents. Let me try and zoom in just a little bit more. And is Aaron or Tyler in here?
Nope.
All right. So not to pick on anyone here, but I do want to point out some things that are kind of red flags for an agent, especially a tech-savvy agent, looking at profiles on your Market Center website. The first thing that we'll notice is the phone number. And if we scroll through here, I would bet your office phone number is 630-778-5800. If you were a referral agent trying to place a referral in this Market Center, would you call the front desk and ask for so-and-so?
Mm-hmm. Probably not.
Probably not. You would kind of skip over them until you found someone that had a, you know, a different phone number. Okay? So this is really important that you look at the profile, the office profile. In fact, this profile is what's called the white pages, and that's all over Keller Williams. So if it's on KW.com, your Market Center website, anywhere that Keller Williams has a profile for you, the data that comes from the white pages is what's being displayed. And that's what we have here.
Who can edit this?
You can.
Oh, I can?
You can. Okay. Yep, and we'll show you where.
Okay.
So it's really important that you take a look at how you're presenting yourself to the world. So in this case, if we've got that office phone number, 630-778-5800, the chances of you getting a referral from an agent in another market is very small. They're not going to want to call in here and try and hunt you down. So they're going to be glancing at those things. The other thing I want you to look at is the website addresses. So if we start at the top here, what do you notice about all of these website addresses?
They're long, they're not custom.
They're not custom, they're long, right.
Well, Janice doesn't have her name in there at all.
Yeah, so these are, when I said earlier that most of the agents in this office, over 150 of you all, have the e-agency website. This is what I'm referring to, and I can tell by this Your KW Agent domain there. So the Your KW Agent means the e-agency website. And you'll notice, like you mentioned here earlier, sometimes they don't have their name in there. For example, Cynthia's domain name is x409552.yourkwagent.com. That's a temporary domain name. When you first get set up with Keller Williams, they just give you random numbers like that, right? So what this tells us is this agent didn't go in there and set up their domain properly, right? They just have that temporary domain name there. And a lot of agents, unfortunately, are in that same situation, not just in this office, but across the country. So it's really important that you take a look at these and see what website's being displayed here for you, okay? So the other thing that you're gonna need to look for, or you should have, and your office does a really great job of this, is a photo. In fact, I think it's hard to find a profile without a photo.
I think they download it, don't they? Mm-hmm.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's really good. Because your chance of getting a referral without a photo is zero. You need to have a photo there. You need to have the domain name set up properly. You need to have the phone number set up properly. So let's take a look at a couple of these. With some domain names set up. Here's one. So Shannon, is Shannon there?
No.
So if we click on Shannon's website, it's gonna take us over to Shannon, I don't know how to pronounce the last name, C.com, okay?
Uh-oh.
And notice what happens here. It's not set up properly. In fact, it's just unfortunately a simple typo in this one that caused that to happen. It looks like they set up the domain name to forward. We can see up top here the Your KW Agent, but they forgot the little colon right here. So if I put the colon in, then Shannon's website will come up. Okay. So we had a really good presentation there. We saw as we were going through all those Your KW Agents, then we got to one, we clicked on it, and it was a broken link. Now what this did was forward. And that's actually not a really good thing for you guys from an SEO perspective. From a search engine perspective. Because when you forward a domain name with Your KW Agent on it, that gives the SEO or the Google juice to Your KW Agent. The SEO always goes to, dry erase? The SEO always goes to this part of the domain.
I don't think we can do it any other way, can we?
We can, yeah. I'm going to show you how to do that. So, I don't know that it's necessary to go back and fix e-agency, But when we're looking at coming onto the new KW websites by Playster, we want to make sure that we have those domain names set up properly so that we're not losing SEO. And I actually saw as I was scrolling through here, let's see if I can find one.
Someone actually used the Playster subdomain. Okay, the My Real Estate platform. That's how we can tell it's a Playster one. If we look at gotta be one in here. Here's one. KW Realty. Does anybody recognize that one? It's the market leader.
Okay. So if you do not set up the domain name properly with the domain that you purchase, you're giving this SEO credit to Keller Williams, to Playster, to someone other than you. And if the whole idea here is for you to get found online, you want it. You want that SEO for yourself. You don't want to be giving that stuff away. Okay. When you set this up properly, it's done with something called a CNAME. And I saw that was written over here, so you must have talked about it with Kevin in the class the other day. You need to set up a CNAME for your domain. And basically what happens when you do that is it hides from the entire world KW Realty, your KW agent, My Real Estate platform. It hides that from the world. More importantly, it hides that from Google so that you can earn SEO. And that's probably when you called GoDaddy the other day or Playster the other day, what they did for you, they set it up with a CNAME. Okay? When we go into Playster, I'm going to show you how to do that. We're not going to talk about it on the agency, but we will talk about how to do that on Playster because this piece is really important. And let me show you why that's important. If we go to, is that Sharon? Mm-hmm. Sharon. So if we go to her domain name here and ask Google what her SEO value is, it's going to give us an indication of whether her website is being found or healthy or not. And you can do this with your domain name as well. You have to do it from a desktop computer or a laptop computer. This doesn't work on a mobile or a tablet. It has to be done on a computer, not a mobile device. But what you need to do is type in site and then colon, whatever the domain name is. And I realize that's kind of hard to see from the back, but that's what's up in the address bar. So it's site, and then colon, whatever your domain is. No www, just the domain. So whatever you purchase, .com. And what this will do is it will go out to Google and it will say, hey, how healthy is my website? And in this case here, I don't know if you can see from the back, there's one page in the index for her domain name. Think that's good or bad?
Okay, so we'll say that again.
There's one page. One result for that domain name.
Oh, that's probably not good.
It's definitely not the best, right? We want to have as many entry points or landing pages or opportunities to be found in our website as possible, in Google as possible. And with one, it's probably not likely that you will get found.
What are the breakout? What's good?
So more is better. Right. Yep. Yeah. Let's take a look at some examples as we go, and we'll take a look at what that looks like for your market. So it's a really good question.
So don't you have to set up those landing pages individually?
Yes. Yeah. So we talked a little bit earlier about if somebody were to be looking online for buying a home around here, what would they type into Google?
Naperville homes for sale.
Okay. So Naperville homes for sale. And we'll see that there's 553,000 pages indexed. And if you're lucky, you're one out of 553,000. Or 20, or 50, or 500, or 5,000 as you build your website, right? So a lot of folks, when they're talking about lead generation, they're talking about their website, they're expecting to get results from their website. This is the problem. They're not getting found because their website doesn't have what some would call Google juice. Their website doesn't have enough content. Their website just isn't showing up there, which means you're not getting leads because you're not getting found. So we look at that chain of events that we started with. Most agents are broken at the top of the chain. Number one, getting found. And we'll talk to agents time and time again, and we'll say, well, what do you think of your website? And they're typically disappointed or frustrated. Anybody frustrated with their website results? Disappointed. Okay? This is it, right here at the very top. If it's broken at the top, it's broken all the way down. So that's why we talk about this. This one is so important. So if we look inside here, we can see that these first few results are ads. You see the little green ad next to it. We see the big boys, Realtor, Zillow, Trulia, Redfin, Homes.com, Zip Realty, C21, CB, some more ads. Let's dig in here and find... What I'm seeing here is a lot of opportunity, because I'm not finding very many agents. Is Dan Ferks an agent?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All right. Does anybody know Dan Ferks?
Yes.
Stay with KW?
No.
Would anybody like to beat him online?
Of course.
All right, so you can do this with any of your competitors. All you have to do is type in site:domain.com, and we can see what Dan Ferks' website looks like to Google. So let's do that. So let's take his domain here. I can remember how to spell that, actually. So we can do site:, Dan Ferks. He has 9,950 pages in the Google Index.
Okay, so is that result showing up like on a monthly basis, or what is that?
Total number of results, total number of pages that Google counted on his website the most recent time it was there.
Is that based on links, or you're saying the landing pages?
So it's based on content on his website.
Okay.
Now, one of the things, the biggest improvement, other than the way it looks, and this is kind of a behind-the-scenes improvement, one of the biggest changes from eAgency to the new websites that are powered by Playster is that all of the listings are indexed. Meaning that out of the box, you could have thousands of pages that you didn't create. And that wasn't the case on eAgency. So all of the listings that you link to on your new websites will show up in this page count if your domain name is set up properly. So if we look at Dan's website, we'll see that he's got user logins, he's got listing searches, registration, he's got some articles that he's set up. But if we dig down into it, we're going to see listing details. 2809 Joe Adler Drive in Plainfield.
Okay. That's a landing page?
Every single one of these is a landing page or entry point into your website. Very few consumers will actually go out and search for a realtor. If a consumer is looking for a real estate agent, they usually ask their friends and family, they remember the agent that sold them the property, they see tons of signs in their neighborhood. They usually get that by referral. Very rarely do they go online saying, I want to find an agent. Typically what a consumer will do is they will go to the search engines and type something in, homes for sale in Naperville, or 2809, whatever this address was. They'll type that in, and then by happy accident, they happen to find an agent. So the idea of having a high number of pages in the search engine is very important to you. And it wasn't possible before on eAgency, and it is possible now on the new KW websites. Okay? Yes?
Can we load our old listings into that as pages, or will it only be moving forward?
So you cannot load any non-active properties in there unless you create a blog post for them. The good news about this is that it loads the pages, gives you credit for the pages, does all of that automatically through the IDX feed. So if you grab a new listing, or if you write about a neighborhood and there are listings in the MLS that are not actually yours, you will get credit for all of those pages as well. So you really can't go back in time. You can go forward, but going forward is not a manual process. It's very simple. It'll pick them up automatically. Okay, so you don't have to load listings into your website ever.
So if I write a blog for a neighborhood, it'll pull all those neighborhood listings and give me a website?
Yes.
Now, is that going to be bloggable on the site?
Yes.
Is there going to be a place where you can actually put it?
Yes,
in a blog?
And I'm going to show you that.
Okay. If you would write a blog then, and I wrote one an hour later or a day later.
After I took them down, what would happen then?
All right.
No, I'm just saying.
Is it getting physical in here? So it's going to matter. There are several factors that are going to be a part of that. how long your domain has been around, the quality of your content, whether you have other third-party websites that respect you and link to you, whether you are a good community provider and link to other third-party websites. So there are many, many things that are going to play into that. What I can tell you is that 553,000 people or pages indexed for Naperville is not competitive at all. When you start to get to 3 million and 5 million, then it's pretty darn hard to get there. The fact that I had to look to page 2 and 3 to find one solo agent, people are asleep at the wheel here. And that is awesome for you all because it's opportunity. And you have the platform now to do it where you didn't before. So it's huge. Questions on that? I see your brain just spinning. It's great. She doesn't want to share.
No, I don't want to interrupt you. Just keep going.
Okay. So this is an important concept here because this is the fuel to get found online. And it doesn't have to be difficult before. I mentioned blogging, I kind of let that slip out. Blogging is like a four-letter word around real estate agents, right? Anybody here wake up this morning and say, I am so excited I'm going to blog today? No, it just doesn't happen. Usually when I say blog, it's when we stop making eye contact, people start packing their stuff up, and they start walking for the door. Because it's just not something that you want to do every day. And there's three reasons, limiting beliefs, excuses, however you want to say it, that real estate agents won't blog. And you probably know what they are. What's number one?
Time.
Don't have the time. Absolutely. Number one. Number two?
Content.
Don't know what to write about. Number two.
Don't
three?
Don't know how often.
Don't know how. Time, content, don't know how. If I could solve those three things for you today, would you promise me to try a blog tonight?
No, absolutely.
Thank you for being honest.
I got a dual video tonight.
I got one no and one absolutely. I'll take it. I'll take it.
No.
We got a little disconnected there. So this is, it's not as hard as it seems to be. Okay, time. I get it. Anybody taken a blogging class before?
No.
Good, don't. It'll scare you to death that you have to have between, 1,200 and 1,500 words and a 2-4% keyword saturation and boom. You'll never write a blog article in your life. What I can tell you right now in Naperville is no one else is either. So all you have to do is just be a little bit better than the next person. You don't need 9,000 pages to beat this guy. You just need some better content, and you can beat this guy. And his website kind of...
It's pretty
I'll stay in culture here, but let's see if it's even responsive. It is responsive. But his website kind of stinks. It doesn't fill up the whole page. It's not that great. You could stomp on this guy with the right amount of effort. And it's not going to take hours and hours and hours a day, or hours and hours a week or month.
I think we're trying to recruit him. We probably don't want to do that.
We don't want to step on him?
He's got a really nice, flushy machine.
Where's his lead area? Is that the contact us?
So, let's see. We can save the listing, which would be a lead. Mm-hmm. Request more information, which would be a lead. These are all lead capture opportunities here.
Okay.
Maybe not in the best, kind of waving and jumping up and down and flashing at him to lead. But he does have some lead capture there. Okay. So this is, I guess my point here is that you could really dominate in this market quite simply with just a little bit of effort. And I want to show you how to do that and what we're looking at here when we do that. I know a couple folks were still waiting on their Playster logins. I'm going to assume that you already have those and you know how to get inside of Playster as I go in here. Once we get in there, if you have questions, then I'll be able to help you out. But if you don't have your login yet, let's kind of table that and we'll talk about it after class. I can help you through that. All right, so we're going to look at, I don't think I have anything local that I can show you. We're going to look at this one. So we're going to log into an agent's website. I'm from Orlando, so I'm going to use an agent in Orlando that... we're going to use as a demo of how to put some good content in here. So we're just going to go into, let's see what we've got here, this website. And once you're logged inside of Playster, there are a lot of options in here, and I know I'm scrolling fast, but let's just kind of go over what we're looking at here. There are a lot of options for you to set up your website and do different things. We're actually going to be working our way backwards today. I know that seems a little counterintuitive. But because we're talking about getting found in SEO, I think it's important that we continue that thought. So that's where we're going to start. So we're going to start over here on the right-hand side for areas. And this is how you build content on your website very easily with listings on it so that you don't have to do any work. Okay? You have to do the work initially, but you don't have to feed the data in there on a regular basis. So this is an area area page. And the idea of an area page title would be that you would call out a specific area. We could say Naperville if we were doing this in Naperville. We can also say, what's a subdivision in Naperville?
Ashbury.
Okay. So you can go big or you can go small. In Orlando, there's an area that's called Baldwin Park. And it's a pretty popular place for real estate agents to try and market and be found, right? So if we were to create an area page for Baldwin Park, what do you think of the name of the page should be?
Baldwin Park.
This is simple stuff. You guys got this. Now it's going to ask you what type of area is this. So you can have a county, a region. Region is actually a state. A locality, which is a city. A postal code or a neighborhood. So if we were doing this in Naperville, Ashbury would probably be a neighborhood. Okay. If we were going to do it all of Naperville, it would be called a locality. So in this case, we're going to say a neighborhood. And then what it's going to do is it's going to go find all of the neighborhoods in the MLS, and it's going to present them to me in this drop-down, in theory. And then we're looking for Baldwin. Okay. So now that piece actually connects this area page over to the MLS, or the IDX, and it's going to pull every single listing in the MLS that's got Baldwin Park selected as the neighborhood. And tomorrow when an opportunity or a listing goes pending or sold, that property is going to come off. And when a new active comes on, that property is going to come on. And you never have to come back to this page ever again to update the listing data. Okay? So this is huge leverage. Huge leverage. Now, the reason why Realtor.com, Zillow, and Trulia have the number 1, 2, 3 positions on your MLS or on your search is because they've got listings. What don't they have? They don't have blog content. They don't have unique expertise. They don't have your expertise. So if you take listings, which they have, and you put your expertise on top of it, you win. Is it a little more complicated than that? Yes. But that's the concept here. So it kind of guides you through how to set these up. And it asks, should this area be featured? What that means is it'll put it over to your homepage and up in the navigation. So you can check yes or no. Sometimes if you're doing a lot of these neighborhoods, you do not want to feature all of your neighborhoods. Let them be landing pages in the back end of your website. It's totally fine if your page that you create has no navigation on how to get there. It's totally fine. But this would be if you wanted to have maybe one for Naperville and you put it up there, right?
Is this considered a landing page?
Yep. Okay. And I'll show you what it looks like when this is done. We can add a bunch of photos to this if you want.
When you set the zip code, can you put multiple zip codes in that zip code?
Not on an area page. On an IDX page, you could. Yeah.
And so, how did you get here again?
Yeah. So just logged in, and on the right-hand side says areas.
Sites.
Click on one of your websites.
But are you
all the way over?
So, click on one of your. Do you have pictures of your websites on your computer?
I buy sites.
Okay, so click on one of your websites. View settings.
Do you not have a site page? You don't have a site page.
Yeah.
We'll come back to that. We'll look at that together. All right, so this is area page. I just click the plus for an area page. We can upload photos. Now we create content. Now, when you're creating blogs in Placer, they just give you a big white space, and you're on your own. Here, they're trying to prompt you to create really good area pages. So there's different sections that they're asking you to fill out so that you end up with good content at the end of it. So the first thing that it's asking you is the headline. So if we were writing a headline for Baldwin Park, what do you think our headline would be?
Baldwin Park, homes for sale.
That's a good idea. Baldwin Park, homes for sale. Anybody else? I like that. I think it might be too salesy too soon.
Okay.
So maybe we would write something about living in Baldwin Park.
Okay.
Right? We're trying to be the area expert first. So we would write something like living.
But you want to have a name
Baldwin.
In there, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay. Very important that the name is in there. Okay. So living in Baldwin Park. We put some copy there. Baldwin Park's a great place to live. Okay. What are consumers concerned about when they're moving to an area? What would we type this section to be?
School
in Baldwin Park, Baldwin Park schools, something along those lines. The schools are good. This is where your area expertise comes in. Don't actually put that in. But yeah. Write about it. What else are people concerned about when they move to Baldwin Park?
The demographics of some kind.
Okay, demographics of some kind.
Parks, things to do. Parks,
yeah, okay. Yeah. How about things to do?
Amenities.
Baldwin Park. Okay, and we can talk about lots of things to do. I can spell it, be dangerous.
Or taxes or something.
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely. Anything that you can provide value, and we go back to this question, if he posts right after you, before you take him out, you could just put more content in it, right? What did he write about? Maybe you write just a little bit better. Mm-hmm. Okay. But there's room enough for both of you. So, yeah, we don't have to make this a ugly thing.
Well, you're not going to know anyway what he wrote unless you go on his site.
Well, yeah, if you start to see him just popping up on the first page, then you're going to go and look. And okay. Yeah, you're going to negotiate back and forth. Now, I should have wrote this on the board. The first one was get found. The second one was what? Does anybody remember? Get found, then?
Click.
You have to get the person to click on your website. If they don't click, it's completely irrelevant. All your SEO work was for naught. So the bottom section of all of the pages on your new KW website say meta title and meta description. Those are important. Because that is what is in blue and black on Google. So this is the title. This is the description. So this is important for you to fill out the meta title and meta description in a way that a real human being, when they see this inside of Google, would want to click on your title because you have a good title and description. Every single page needs this. If you do not do it, PlayStore will do its best attempt to put some stuff there, but it's probably not going to be what you want it to be.
The black stuff would translate into which field?
Blue is the title, black is description. So when we come back over into our PlayStore site that we were working on, we can see here a meta title. Now, those should be, if you're worried about it, less than 55 characters. Okay? So you want to keep that short and sweet. I like to say everything you ever wanted to know about living. Where? Okay. And then I would write something in the description that if there were a human being reading that, I would say something to the effect of Baldwin Parks, best known resource for living and working in Baldwin Park. View every home for sale in Baldwin Park. Now, if you were a buyer or seller coming to that and you saw that on Google, would that get your attention?
Yes.
No? She's out.
I'm out.
You're out. How come?
It doesn't grab my attention.
Okay. So then come up with something that would grab your attention and put that in there and try it. You can certainly A-B test this too. You can try half of your communities with this idea and half of your communities with that and see what works.
Is there anywhere that we can find out if that is working?
You'll see traffic coming to your website and leads coming to your website.
So
you could also set up what's called Google Analytics, which will show you what pages are getting viewed on your website.
You can do that even though it's with the KW?
You can. Okay. You can and you should. We'll talk about
question.
It.
You said under 55 characters for your title. How about for your description?
You'd have to Google it. I think it's around 150 or 160. If you type in...
Like under 160.
Correct. And what happens if you go over is that it's just kind of dot, dot, dot.
Right.
This one here went over, for example. So it'll just dot, dot, dot if you go over. So even if you go over, make sure that your good stuff is to the left so that people can see it. All right. So I'm going to save this page right here. And I've created a page called Baldwin Park. And I'm going to click on this page and see what that page looks like. Now, let me copy that. There we go. Come on now. The internet's not allowed to go out in the middle of class.
Seen it the last couple days.
What's up?
Should have seen it when Kevin was here.
Was it bad?
Yeah, it was rough.
Worst case scenario, I'll jump on my cell phone, but let's see if we can get this to load.
We should just show nothing right now, right? You just
It'll actually show everything that I've created there. So we'll be able to see my content that I put there. Most importantly, all the listings.
No.
So that's what we're hoping to come up with here.
So it'll pull up not necessarily your own.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. Every listing in the MLS. For whatever reason, that page is not loading. Let me go to let's go here. Let's see if she created her pages. There we go. Okay, so this is a website that we've gone in and done a refresh on, so it looks a little bit different than the standard Keller Williams one. But this is an agent that created a whole bunch of area pages on her homepage. So we can see here, she's in the DC, Maryland area. So she's got Arlington, Falls Church, Alexandria, McLean, Prince George. So all of these different areas around the market that she served, she's created area pages just like I did for Baldwin Park a moment ago. Okay? So we're going to pretend like this is Baldwin Park. So what you'll see here is it creates a page with all of the listings inside there. It looks like she didn't put much content in there, which is a shame. But you can see all of the listings that are inside that that particular area. In this case, it's Arlington.
And what did you call that, where she had each of the different subject areas?
Those are the land
areas. Every single page on your website is an opportunity for somebody to land there. I wouldn't say get hung up on the term for that, because every time somebody comes into your website, that's an opportunity for them to land. Very few people from the internet will ever see your homepage.
Can we take you back to one level here?
Sure.
We're in areas, but we're looking for, where did you find that locality, area, neighborhood, zip code?
Possibly. If you're not seeing it there, let's look at it after class. It might be that your MLS is not set up yet.
Okay.
Sure. So does everybody understand the concept of that? Is we've got a page that we created, one page that we created, and how many listings are on there is up to the number of properties in your MLS.
So, I did one for Downers Grove, so I'm starting to see all these Downers Grove things.
Great. How many listings are there at Downers Grove?
A lot.
Okay.
A lot.
So, the point of this whole exercise is that you can create one page, and you can leverage the entire MLS to give you tens of pages, hundreds of pages, thousands of pages. So that guy that we were looking at before with 9,000 pages is no big deal.
So you can't do the recent sales, like closed sales?
Not in this market with this product, no. So, you know, this one here, Alexandria, it's got, I think, 96 pages of listings that are attached to that.
And right? those don't necessarily are her listings.
They're not her listings, correct.
And it doesn't matter for purposes of what we're trying to accomplish.
Yeah, it's got the whole, whatever your market has, the disclaimers, the broker reciprocity,
correct.
The logos, all of that kind of stuff that's a requirement for your MLS, correct.
Keep us out of jail.
To keep you out of trouble, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's great.
So
to bring
if you click on one of those listings, does it show anywhere on there?
It will say listing courtesy of whoever, I think.
Right.
Depends on your market. On our market, it says listing courtesy of. There's no phone number, contact information, anything. It just tells you who the broker is that owns that listing. In this case, it does. So in this one was a Long and Foster. So it says listing courtesy of Long and Foster.
Okay.
So for this example, there were 96 pages with 10 listings on there. Help me out. What's the math? 960 pages, right? She wrote one page and got 960 pages of credit. This wasn't possible before any agency. Okay? So So if I searched, what was the address on this property?
You could spend like weeks doing this stuff.
So this was 4920 30th Street, North Arlington, Virginia. She's got a page in the Google Index for that. Okay? And every single other property that's linked to that.
So that's just automatic. She doesn't have to create this.
Correct. All of this over here is leveraged out by the MLS, and any time a property comes or goes, it adds and subtracts it from that list of homes. Okay? So earlier when you asked, could you go in and add, you potentially could create blog posts if you wanted to, but you don't need to because this leverage does all the work for you. So this is huge, you guys, huge. You don't have to worry about that stuff. All right? So getting found and getting people to click, we're getting found by leveraging the MLS with our unique local expertise. We're writing good descriptions and titles so that people would click on us, and that's going to bring people into our website. So that's what we're working with here. Any questions on that?
So could you scroll up to the top just
sure.
a moment? Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Any questions on that? Getting found or getting people to click on your website?
At what point does this person keep seeing whatever he wants to see before he actually gets in touch with you, or is there like a limit of, you know, 5 times or?
That's a great question. We hold it until we get to the point of lead capture.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a great question.
I was just looking at that get in touch on there.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Is there a flow chart on, you know, starting display surveying, to this, then do this, then do this, then go here?
Yes. Did you put your name on the sign-in sheet? Your email address?
Yes.
Please do. Yes, we have a 5-minute setup video. Literally, I show you all of the things that you need to touch in 5 minutes.
Awesome.
I do it really fast. I don't expect you to do it that fast. Mm-hmm. But you watch, pause, go do
right.
what I did. Watch, pause, go do what I did.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, and we'll be sending that video out at the end.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Okay. So click, get found, and click. We've got those covered. So I want to show you, I know we started all the way at the right side of Playster. We're going to work our way backwards and talk about some of the other areas that are important to you. If you happen to have multiple office locations, you can put those in here. Most of you are not going to worry about that, so I think that's pretty, don't need it. All of you should have testimonials. This is a place where you can load in all of the ooey gooey, how much your clients love you, and present that to the world in a format that doesn't seem braggy, right? It gives you the opportunity to have testimonials in there in a really nice format, and you can load your site full of hundreds of them. However many you have, you can load inside here, okay? Just like with area pages, there's a little plus when you get inside there. If we click the plus, it's gonna give you similar questions like when we were on area pages. In this case, what's the title of the review? You might find something that was, you know, just a piece of gold in that review. Michelle was the best thing that ever happened to me, right? That would be your title, okay? So what would the title be? Then whatever the person wrote, you copy and paste that into the testimonial section. The referrer is the person. You know, if I referred or made that testimonial, I would say that Ken Granger. And then you could put maybe where I lived for the affiliation, or maybe I'm a doctor, or whatever it happens to be. So it has a nice signature underneath it of who built, you know, who made this testimonial for you. Features, okay? And then what do we notice at the bottom again?
Meta title and description.
Okay? Meta title and description is really important if somebody's going to be looking for you specifically. So if I was looking for Ken Granger, the realtor in Naperville, I would want to see all of this great stuff about Ken Granger, the realtor in Naperville. So when you create these descriptions and titles on your testimonials, you don't make it about the area, you make it about you, the realtor. Okay. So in this case, we might say that Ken Granger was the best thing that happened to me. Yeah. Well, we only have 55, so we're going to keep it. All right? And then we would take a little excerpt of that testimonial so that people were seeing. You know, have you ever Googled yourself?
Yes.
Yeah. So you would see, like, all these testimonials there and be like, wow, this person's really amazing. So So that's the idea here, is that you put those testimonials in a way that you are featured when they search your name, they're going to find you. So your title should always have your name inside of it. Okay? And then you just find some gooey part of the testimonial to make that one stand out from all the other 50 or 100 that you happen to have that you're going to put in there. You might not have that many. If you have 5 or 6, that would be great. Alright. Any questions on testimonials? That one's pretty straightforward. I won't save that into his website. That would be kind of funny, actually. Anyone here on a team or manage a team? Maybe we'll grow a team. So this here, agents, allows you to feature and profile the different agents and members on your team. So even if you don't have a team with, you know, buyer's agents and listing agents, you may potentially want to put your transaction coordinator, your closing coordinator, whoever you happen to have on your team can be set up in here as agents. Okay? Obviously, when you create the profile, you would say what this person does. You don't want to insinuate that they're all licensed real estate agents. But you can use this on more than just, as more than just the additional agents that are on your team. Okay? So that's under agents, very similar to the rest of it. When we click plus, it's going to ask for the name, their bio.
Would you re-enter yourself?
If you're a sole member, I wouldn't.
Like if you were a husband or wife?
Then yes, I would. Yep, that's
so
a very good question.
Me there and my husband.
Yes. So if you're going to use this section, even though you own the site, you should also put your bio or your profile in here as well.
Okay.
If not, if you are a solo agent and you're not using this section, I would create a separate about page for me. I wouldn't complicate it with all this garbage if it wasn't necessary. Okay? Social media for those people, excerpts, what's at the bottom? Title and description. It's very easy to kind of skip over those after you've been writing a few of these and just get lazy about it, but don't, because this is gold for you. Title and description. Any questions on how to use the agent section? Yes?
So for each person on your team, you would just click and add each person
correct
with their bio?
Yes. Now, some of the things that I would, if you are adding multiple folks here, make sure that the photos look very similar, right? You don't want to have somebody outside, somebody inside. You want to have it consistent. And then make sure the data that you're collecting from those agents and putting on here is consistent as well. You wouldn't want to have some with a Facebook link and some without. You wouldn't want to have some with a cell phone number and some without. Make sure that whatever you're putting in there is the lowest common denominator across all of the folks that you're going to enter there, so that it doesn't feel favoritism and it doesn't look bad to the consumer on the other side. The other thing that I would caution if you are using this section here, remember I told you earlier that one of our things is that we want people to stick on our website? Don't put all of your agent's social media here. I don't know about you, but when I go to Facebook, it's the end of my day. Like, I'm lost, right? I'm just in there. I'm in Facebook. We don't want to do that at some point where somebody's thinking about investing in you and being, you know, a client of yours. We don't want to send them over to Facebook where their friend's talking about their dog and they watch a cat video and then all of a sudden they're sunk. Okay? So think about those kind of things when you're filling these out. I would suggest that you don't do any social media. I wouldn't do that either. The whole idea for me of social media and Facebook is to get people in to my lead capture, get people into my property search to find a home, to lead capture so that I get their contact information, not the other way around. I don't want to take them from my lead capture place into a social place. Yes?
So help me understand, you don't want to send them on a bunny trail. Okay, because once they start there, then they're going to go to Facebook, and then they're going to lose of why we're here to begin with.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Correct. So that goes for your homepage, as well as your individual agents inside of here.
What about if a seller is looking at this going, well, where are you going to be putting my house?
So that's you can put that in the bio. I think that you should create a page specifically for sellers that talks about my marketing plan and all of the things that I'm going to do for you. Me going to your Facebook page and seeing that you have 100 people liking your page and you're going to post my listings there does not get me excited.
Yeah. As these started to roll out, we're talking about teams and we're trying to figure out how to set up our team website. Mm-hmm. Do you suggest that each agent sets up their own?
I think it depends on your business model. That's a really good question. If there's like a one rainmaker and then the leads are kind of distributed out to the team, I think you should do one website.
Okay.
If each team member is responsible for bringing in leads and kind of working their own leads, then I think that you should let them have individual sites. One of the things that you could potentially do We talked earlier about, you know, your KW agent getting SEO, or KW Realty getting SEO, or Placer getting SEO. You could actually do that with you and your agents as well. So do you have a domain name for your team?
Yeah, there's a separate website we're going to transfer.
Okay. What's, do you mind sharing what the name is?
Alisa Lynn Holmes.
Lisa, let's just call it Lisa Holmes because I didn't hear that last part, sorry. Lisa Holmes. You could have ken.lisaholmes.com, michelle.lisaholmes.com, sherry.lisaholmes.com. So you're getting credit for all of the efforts that those websites have. So that's one way that you could do it in an environment like that. So, and I'd be happy to talk to you afterwards and figure out what's best for that equation. But I have two schools of thoughts on that. Okay. Any other questions on the agent part? All right, here's that four-letter word again. Now, I asked you earlier, and thank you for being honest, if I could take those three excuses away, would you actually blog? I want to look at the blog section here. Okay? Yes, sir.
I've got a whole library of about 1,000 blogs that I used to write on 7 years ago.
Okay.
Just copy and paste.
Potentially. But where are they now?
ActiveRank.
Okay.
Are you familiar with it?
I am.
Yeah, I've been playing back here trying to copy and paste one.
Yeah. You potentially could. ActiveRank already has been indexed for that. So by putting it on your website, it would be considered duplicate content, and you may not get as much credit for it because it's just a Me Too blog. Okay. Now, if someone were coming in, though, and seeing, holy cow, this guy really, you know, knows what he's talking about, he's been doing this for 7 years, there's some value to that. So I don't know that you would get any SEO value off the last 7,000. You get some. You get much more having 7,000, and then all of a sudden you're active again and putting new ones on there.
And I could, from now on, just write on this, whatever's up.
Yeah, I would encourage you to do that.
What's that?
I would encourage you to do that.
So write directly through the Placer.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. Are you a rainmaker with ActiveRank?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I was.
Are you grandfathered in?
I was, yeah, way before.
Okay. So prior to Ben Kinney owning it, it was, you know, agents put a lot of content in there. It built this huge kind of following. Google loved it. And then as soon as it got popular, what did they do? They charged agents.
Yeah.
Yeah. They charged agents for their own content.
Yeah.
Agents built that. It was just a weird business model. So it is a nice place to have. It's great to have all of that content. If it were in here, you would own that SEO. You wouldn't be hostage to somebody saying, now you got to pay me for it. I think their business model is a little different now, but that's the way it was when I first started. Okay. All right. So I don't have time. I don't know what to write about, and I don't know how. I would ask for 15 minutes a week. If you could put 15 minutes a week into your website and write one article for your website, leveraging listings, talk about that. You could have 5,000, 10,000, 50,000 pages at the end of the year on your website in 15 minutes a week.
When you say leveraging listings, say I got a new listing in Ashbury, for instance, and I just write something brief about great, you know, this great new home with the open kitchen or what have you, that would be leveraging listings?
So you would write that, and then below it you would say, if this kitchen is not your favorite, here are all the other listings in Ashbury.
Sounds like a good strategy.
And then you, boom, put all those other properties on. Did you just get a new listing in Ashbury?
No, I'm just making fun of you.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
He's getting personal.
is that your farming area? You dominate that area?
I intend to dominate
you,
the
yes,
area.
Yes, you're going to dominate that area. I love it. Okay, so 15 minutes is all I'm asking for.
Is this just verbiage, or can you actually put in a video?
Put in a video? You can do anything. So 15 minutes is all that I want on blogging. I know it sounds like a lot because your next kind of limiting belief is I don't know what to write about. How many people in this room send at least one email per day? Raise your hands. 5? 10? 15? 25? They're starting to fall now. You guys are writing all day, every day about local real estate. About homeowners association, about inspections, about age of this, about so-and-so that. If you go back through your email, I bet you have 50 to 100 to 1,000 blog posts ready to go. And all you have to do is copy, take the personal stuff out, copy and paste it over. This is a great resource. Earlier today I asked, why do you want a website? One person said that because they want to have resources, right? Well, this is a great way to be a resource. Why do I need an inspection? Why do I need an appraisal? What is all this other kind of stuff? make that a blog article, and the next time this person asks you that question, just copy and paste the link instead of typing in another email. You have so much content in your email that you could probably fill up the blogging calendar for the entire year. 15 minutes, you have topics already in your email, and I'm going to show you how to blog. Okay, so I'm going to take that last limiting belief away. It's as simple as pushing the plus, just like we did on the agents pages, just like we did on testimonial and the areas page. All you do is push the plus. We're going to put a title of our blog post. What was the name of the listing that you took in Ashbury?
That was
123 Ashbury Lane. Sounds good. I don't know how to spell. It's Ashbury for me.
3715 to follow.
Sounds good. Oh, you're going to let him have that one?
Huh?
You're going to let him have that one?
Easy.
All right. So we're going to put some content in there about this great listing. You said the kitchen was amazing. We're going to say this kitchen is amazing. Let me open up Firefox. I don't have Firefox. We'll go to Safari. Anybody used YouTube before? If you are doing video, how many people here are doing video or plan to do video in their business? You must host your video on YouTube. YouTube is the number two search engine on the planet. Google's number one, YouTube is number two. So if you're thinking about doing video, don't look at all those third parties that'll host the video for you, put it on YouTube. It has to be there. So we're just gonna grab a video. This Jaws video is probably a good kitchen, right?
Yeah.
All you have to do with this website is copy the URL of the video. So you open the video on YouTube, you grab the address, and that's all you need to do. So we're going to copy it.
You don't have to do the share.
And we're going to paste it. Did you see that?
Yeah.
Just put the video right inside there. All right. What do we have at the bottom?
Your medicine.
Title and description. Okay. So if we save this, I'm hoping this website will load this time. Now we have this listing about Ashbury Lane. I totally butchered the spelling.
Could the page title and the meta title be the same?
It should, yes, it can be the same.
Okay.
It absolutely can be the same. I have a feeling my team is working on this website that's causing it to break. Yep. I'm not going to be happy about that, but.
How much for your team to work on my website?
Who asked that question? Yeah. It's different for different people.
That's coming.
Okay, so yeah, that's what they were doing. They were loading it from local. So this is that blog post that I just made. Now, obviously, there'd be some content there. What the cool thing about these videos, when you do it this way, is that that video does not take the person to YouTube. This is very important. Remember I told you don't want people leaving. When I play this video, it plays right in my website. So if this were a neighborhood tour or whatever, that video would be right inside the website and play right on there. And that's important because people don't leave, but it also builds more time and investment in your website. So they're seeing this great home and this kitchen tour and this great neighborhood tour, and then all of a sudden they're in there clicking on properties and clicking on homes, and all of a sudden they So that's the goal here. So blogging doesn't have to be painful or be difficult. It does take a little bit of time, but it's as simple as going in here, pushing that little plus, and writing a little bit of content. Doesn't have to take a whole day.
So when you post a video, it's not picking up words in that in your blog post, right? Isn't that what Google looks for, is different words?
I posted that this kitchen was great. That would have been a nice big long paragraph of content. Okay. So yeah, to your point, you would want to have some good content there so Google would pick up on it. Absolutely. I'm sorry to make that clear.
Are community events a good blog post?
Great things to do, yes. I have an agent in South Orlando that's actually this agent that we're playing with. He has a website called I Love Hunter's Creek, which is another area that of Orlando that's pretty popular for agents to try and farm. So he's created not only a website for it, but also a Facebook page, and he posts all of the events there that are going on. And if you, for example, want to know what time the fireworks are in Hunter's Creek, you type in fireworks Hunter's Creek, he's the first page that pops up there. For everything that's going on. What time is movie in the park? Boom, it's his article. So those are amazing. And the double-edged sword to that is that now he gets people calling him and saying the neighbors put their trash out on Wednesday instead of Thursday because they think he's the HOA. So there's a little bit of problem. Some of the best success stories in there is he's got about 6,000, I can show you the Facebook page, 6,000 or so people following him on Facebook. And they had lost dogs. And somebody will post, I lost my dog. 6,000 people in the neighborhood would be looking for this dog. They'd reunite the dog, and guess who gets credit for it? It's brilliant.
Besides our listings on the MLS, is there anything else we can connect with to gain content, their content, like a local, like the Naperville Library? Can we put something on our page so that we get boosted with all the Naperville Library content?
Mm.
You know what I mean? I don't know how to say it right.
Do you want to leverage other people's content? Is that what you're asking?
Right.
It would be considered duplicate content, so it would not give you the credit that you were looking for from an SEO perspective.
Okay.
However, it could give your consumer the information that they were looking for, and you could, you know, get it out of way from your consumer because the information was there. But you wouldn't all of a sudden get credit from the search engines for that. So this is the Facebook page that I mentioned to you, this is his Facebook page, I Love Hunters Creek. You obviously all know that it's been pretty tough down in Orlando lately, so there's a lot of
Right.
I completely disconnected from Facebook the last 3 days.
Yeah.
2 days, actually. So he posts, for example, a little bit further down here once we get past last weekend. Who's ready for some pizza? The house of pizza located at the shops of whatever. So he's just posting on things that are going around the community. School's out. 1,948 people saw this post about school being out.
So it's kind of a blog that he's using it for,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So when you post it over on your blog on your KW website, you copy and paste that URL and then you paste it over on Facebook. So that when somebody says read more, it takes them over to your website. So it's amazing to do community events and be that voice and that, you know, gosh, I bet this person knows what's going on in the community. Amazing for you.
So you're taking them from here to there, but not from there.
Correct.
To Facebook.
Correct. Because the lead capture's there. If they saw Facebook, they've already liked my page.
Right.
So they're a name, but I might not have their email address. I might not know if they're trying to buy or sell. I don't know anything more about them other than they have a Facebook profile. But if I can get them engaged over on my website, I can grab a lot more information, more valuable information, and moving my transaction along than I would ever get from Facebook. Cool?
Yep.
Earlier on, just down this point, as I understand it, to be on the website, we capture that information. There are individuals in our universe that can go on your Facebook page, creep around, but never be identified.
Correct.
And there's no way to capture them as
right.
a potential client.
Right.
Correct.
Thank you.
Correct. All right. So that's blogging. It doesn't have to be super complicated. Pages are very similar to a blog. Again, we're working from right to left. I know it seems a little counterintuitive, but the opportunities
to create pages on your website. And I would look at pages like permanent information. While a blog is going to be around forever, we're never going to delete them. A thing like about me would be permanent. That page would be something that would always be on your website, where your blog would kind of change based on what's going on in your business at that time or what's going on in your neighborhood at that time. So about me would be a good page. My featured properties would be a good page. Anything that's kind of core to your business is where you can put your pages. Earlier we talked about marketing plan, like where would you talk about all of the things that I'm gonna do to list your home or to sell, help sell your home. You could create a page called marketing plan. So that would be a good use of pages. So it's just as simple as creating blog posts. You can see here that we created some pages in there already. One for a mortgage calculator, that's a good one. Listing search, blog content about. So very simple, you push the plus, and then you could write something in there like my marketing plan. And then you'd say, this is all the stuff I do. And then you would come down here and do what? Title and description, and hit save. You could then put videos in there, et cetera. Pardon me?
Did you talk about like meta description? Should it be words or?
Yes,
like
it's the black on Google.
Meta title.
This is the title is the blue, and this is the description, the black.
Oh, so you just copy and paste it? Or
no, you would write something unique. You'd write something unique that a human, when they read that, would pick your listing or advertisement, for lack of a better term, over the other ones on the page.
Okay.
So something compelling.
So where would you put this, like this open house that they're suggesting here in this site? Where would you put that?
How does
it
get there?
Open house.
Where
yeah.
Are you?
So this is coming from Redfin. They have a different type of feed, so that wouldn't be possible on your
site. So there wouldn't be a place like we could do something like that.
So Playster at this point does not have are open houses in your MLS feed?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
They have not integrated it into Playster yet. So some markets have it, some don't. So it's not super important to them yet. But it's not an option on the platform yet to have open house listings.
Could you just create a page though with open houses?
You could. You'd have to manage it yourself, which would be kind of. The worst thing that you could do is create that page and not keep up with it.
Right.
So if you're committed to going in there and changing it all the time,
mm-hmm.
That'd be great. Yep, blog about it would be perfect. Yeah. That way you don't have to keep that page up to date. Nothing crazy drives me crazier than going there and seeing that the last update was in 2014. You will lose every bit of credibility that you gained with your consumer by doing that.
Yeah.
Right. So earlier someone asked, and I forget, I think it was on this side of the room, if you could do multiple zip codes.
Right.
Who was that?
Eva.
Always Eva, right?
Yes.
Multiple zip codes is what's called an IDX page, and that's in the pages section. Seems counterintuitive, it's not over in areas. It's in the pages section. This is actually an upgrade from Playster called an IDX page. And this gives you the ability to add and add and add and add and add search criteria. So in this case, you said multiple zip codes. You could just go down here and say zip, and then add, and then you just type them in, whatever those zip codes are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Right, so you just put all of your zip codes in there and you'd be able to build out those pages. That is called IDX pages, and it's part of what they call Pro Sites. Pro, that's not dark enough. Pro Sites. It includes IDX pages.
Oh, so we're not saying that.
You won't have that in yours, right? Because it's an upgrade. The Pro Site upgrade is $55. It includes IDX pages. We're going to talk about it in a minute. You had asked me earlier about lead capture. It
is
comes
that
with
annually,
advanced,
monthly?
Monthly. Advanced lead capture. And then map based search. So those three things are the package. I think they give you a discount if you do it annually, though. It's not whatever that is, 6 something. I think it's discounted.
So if our subdivisions aren't coming up now, is that coming, or is our MLS saying no?
Let's take a look at that individually afterwards and make sure. And then if we find the answer, we'll put it out on the email. Okay. All right. So there are other page types in here as well. The only one that's the upgrade is this one we just looked at, is the IDX pages. You can create an about page. If you use the agents thing before, your agents index, blog index, client profiles, contacts, testimonials, featured listings, office listings, all kinds of stuff are in there. All of those are included. The only one that's the upgrade is the IDX pages. Any questions about pages or posts? No?
How did you get to the zip code again?
So under pages, I changed the page type, which they say template,
uh-huh.
over to an IDX page. If you don't
have
that,
you have
to have the upgrade.
So
yep.
It's not there.
Okay.
But you're still getting a capture page.
Correct.
Just not that particular type.
So yeah, we'll get over that to the next one.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So pages, posts, we're good on that? All right. On the first tab, this is what we talk about in the 5-minute setup video that I'll send you in that email. On the first tab are several sections that you really have to fill out in order for your page to get going, or in order for your site to really be ready to go. Specifically, your IDX has to be set up and selected. So in the back, if you want to look at IDX integration, make sure that it is selected. A lot of times when your IDX is set up, it's not actually just, you have to activate it basically, right? You just got to push the button. So check that first. You want to make sure that that's in place. Global filters. If you are a luxury agent and you do not want to show a home under 50,000 on your website, you can set that in global filters. If you only work with a certain type of property, you can set that in global filters. So if you want to restrict anything from being viewed, you would do that in global filters.
When you talk about the global filters, is that based on list price, or can that be geographical as well?
So the additional criteria we can add here, let's see. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. I don't know what your MLS covers in Orlando. It covers like, I'm not sure how familiar you are, but it covers all the way to Daytona Beach to Tampa, which is 3 hours of driving.
Right. Correct.
Agents aren't going to do that. So you can get rid of all that stuff outside.
Okay, so you can narrow the field.
Correct.
In this format.
Global filters, yep.
Thank you.
Now, I think you can either include or exclude, let's see here. Filtered listings. So, for example, if you filter everything out that you want to exclude, but there's still a home over there that you want to include, you can add that one in specifically.
Thank you.
So you can exclude and then go find that one and put it in. Okay? So that is what global filters are. Featured listings are very important because by default, it starts showing on your featured listing section of your website, it starts showing every single property in your MLS. Well, that's not what you want on featured properties usually. Usually on featured properties, you want to show only your listings or potentially your team's listings or potentially the office listings. So that's what you would use under featured listings. You would come in here and set that criteria. The most important criteria to set is your agent ID. And by doing that, everything else will be excluded from featured listings, and only yours would show up. Does that make sense?
Or the office ID.
Or the office ID, or agent ID, and you could put two or three because there are several people on your team.
So you can use the office ID.
Correct. On the old system, you used to have to ask permission for the other agent to be able to show their properties.
Right.
I think that's still a good professional courtesy. You know, just ask. If it's all office listings, you have permission,
yeah,
right? Because it's a brokerage. But if you want to show another agent's listings, I think it's just a good professional courtesy to say, I'm a little short on listings this month, and I'd like to feature yours on my website. Are you cool with that? Is anybody in the room going to say no? Not usually. There may be a reason that they would say no, but it's a good professional courtesy to ask for you. So by default, if you don't set your featured listings, it's going to have all the listings in the MLS on your homepage. If your IDX is not set up and you load your website, you're going to get all of Boston, Massachusetts as featured properties. Has anybody seen that yet?
No.
Okay. Don't freak out. It just means your IDX is not set up. So yeah, don't launch your website if it's got Boston, Mass properties on there. Open house we talked about earlier. You can add your open houses in here if they are yours. Theme selection. So there are 8 different themes for you to choose. The Madison theme is the one that everybody gets out of the box from Keller Williams. You can choose any of the 6 other ones that are in there, if you choose 7 other ones in there if you choose to do that. We're going to take a look at the live sites in just a minute, but you can choose different colors of what you want the site to look like and different templates if you want to choose one of the different templates.
Can you choose your own or no?
One of these 8.
Okay.
So you can choose your own of one of these 8.
Okay.
Yeah,
so you can't just choose your picture. Okay.
Yeah, unfortunately, no.
Okay.
Yes?
I was messing with that yesterday and I chose like the blue one just to see, you know. It looks like it created a separate website. Is that right?
It shouldn't have. It created 2 sites for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll look at that offline. It shouldn't have. Yeah. Did you have a question?
When you choose one of these, I noticed, or I don't think you can choose like a font color.
No.
Sometimes it's hard to read the content.
Yeah.
If you're putting that like something on your slideshow.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so there's 2 things going on. One, sometimes it's the font color, sometimes it's the color of the picture, right? If they're just 2 light colored items, you'd have that collision. But unfortunately, there's no way to change that as you all. Somebody said it a little bit earlier when they asked, how can we have you guys do your sites? We have the keys to unlock that through what's called a website refresh, where we basically can design the whole thing. It looks like a custom site inside there. But absent that, there's really no way to control those things. All right, so there are 8 different themes that you can choose. The 2 Madison ones are exclusive to Keller Williams, so no one else will have access to those. The other 6, any agent from any brokerage or signs up with Playster can use those. Okay, so the only one unique to you guys is Madison.
So how do you know that? 2 Madison ones. What does it say?
KW.
So no one, if you're with RE/MAX and you log in there, they're just not there.
Okay.
Was that your question?
Well, no, out of the eight, how do you know which ones are the ones that are
specific? Oh, it says Madison.
Oh, okay. That's what I was asking. Okay.
Yeah, sorry about that. So it says that right up here, Madison Metro.
I didn't notice.
Or
okay.
Madison. All right, the slideshow, this is where you can customize a little bit your website. There are some default slideshows inside of here that you can choose from, or you can upload your own, and I would highly encourage you to upload your own. This is, the great thing about these websites is that they look good. The great thing about Keller Williams with 140-some thousand agents is that there's a lot of agents. If all 140-some thousand of you use the same theme, it's going to be pretty boring on your office website. Everybody's going to look exactly the same. This is one opportunity for you to customize that by uploading your own images. So while there are some attractive ones there, while there are some attractive ones there, you should upload your own slideshow. Okay? And then where that will show up is in this area right here.
So the
formatting stays the same, but the pictures can change.
Correct.
Yeah, that's right.
Everything else stays exactly the same.
So the Madison Metro picture will come up first, and then it'll be followed by whatever we insert?
No, it would just be whatever you insert. That's a good question. So none of the photos that are stock photos from Keller Williams would show up at all if you add your own.
So under theme selection, I've got Madison Metro selected, but if I insert a slideshow, it'll override?
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. Okay. Social networks, this is an opportunity for you to link over to your social networks. It's going to put them on the Metro theme. It's going to put that stuff in the bottom. I'm totally cool with it being at the bottom. Not cool with it being at the top by your phone number. Right? So if you pick a theme and it's got your phone number and then Facebook there, I don't think that's a really good idea. I would ixnay the Facebook. So Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Pinterest, blah.
So you're saying it's okay?
In the footer at the bottom.
Okay,
like,
at the footer.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would not put it up at the top.
So if it's already embedded, like for Facebook,
you're stuck with it. Yeah, I would take it out.
You can just disable it.
Yeah, that's what I would suggest. Yeah, I would suggest just deleting it if that's the case. Some of the themes have it right up at the top next to the phone number, and I think that's not a good idea. All right, social networks, search form. So you all, as part of your agreement or contract with Keller Williams, get what they call the Omnibar or Omnibox search. And basically, that's like Google. When you go to Google and
start typing in Naperville Homes, it kind of says for sale. It figures it out for you. Mm-hmm. What this search box does is it does that for your clients as they're looking for homes. So if they say Naperville home with pool, it's going to start listing, you know, those kind of things for them. That's included. I think they charge $10 or $15 or $20. I don't know exactly how much it is to other brokerages, but it's included for you guys. So that's part of your deal, is this Omnibox with auto-suggest. So I would encourage you to use that. In fact,
I think they're forcing it now. You used to be able to choose like other different options. I think they're forcing it now. But I would encourage you to use this because it's great for people that are searching on the site.
How do you use it? I don't understand it.
Is that a plug-in or what are you saying?
It's an upgrade for how the search works. Let me see if that's like at this site.
I thought it was on the Madison.
Okay, perfect. So this is Orlando. What was the neighborhood we used as an example? Was that Baldwin Park?
Yeah.
Okay, so if we type in Baldwin, see how it's suggesting this stuff for me?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what this Omnibox with quick search or whatever we call it,
but
smart search.
How do you set it up customers?
You don't need to. What would you want to change about it? Anything in particular?
Where you're going to place it or?
Can't move anything unless you do a refresh. Can't do anything. So, again, this is your consumer coming in there. So whatever's in your consumer mind, you don't want them to try and think like you. You want them to type whatever they're thinking of. So if I was a zip code kind of person, I would type in 32837, and it's going to suggest that that's a zip code.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So the reason why the customize was there is there were several different other options where you could do an advanced search, you could do neighborhoods. So, like, there were other things that you could do. You could add to your search bar, so your search bar had all this garbage on it. But that's not necessary anymore because whatever the consumer wants to type in, they can. So I just started typing the zip code and it suggested that for me. If I wanted to do Hunter's Creek, and then, let's see. Hunter's Creek condo, now it's starting to suggest price ranges for me and that kind of stuff. All right, so it's trying to kind of encourage the person into the right bucket of homes or the right bucket of criteria that will suit their needs. So that's called the Omnibox, and that's an upgrade that you guys get for free. You don't have to pay for that.
So that's not something that we have to even think about.
No. Okay. You used to have to pick it, but that's why when I was curious, I went in there. All the other options are gone, but this one, so you have to use it. The menu. So this is the navigation along the top of your website. All right. So you can rearrange that if you want to rearrange that. If you want to have contact before listings, you can do that. Okay. So it's pretty simple. Just drag stuff around. You can rearrange your menu. Okay. And then this is important for you all. Site info. All of the information under site info populates the different fields throughout your website. For example, your brand name, your logo, your name, your email address, your phone number, your photo, the office address for compliance in the footer of your website. All of this information must be filled out. So if you do nothing tonight but go watch that 5-minute video and do this section, you'll be in really good shape. All the other stuff that we talked about today is gravy, and it's great, and it's important, but this page you have to get through in order to successfully launch your site and be in compliance. Otherwise, you could be in big trouble.
What's on the top of the page?
So it's called site info.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What do you mean by brand name in there?
So at the top of your website, the header of your website, it says something. That could be a logo or it could be text. So in this case, I think we have the logo and the text. But we have the name turned off, so let me update that and show you what that looks like. So see where brand name goes? And then tagline?
What is brand name?
It could be your name. It could be Naperville's best home search. It could be, you know, that's probably a claim you probably shouldn't make, but it could be something along those lines.
Our office name needs to be in there somewhere. Right.
So, I don't know, do you have an equal prominence law in the state of Illinois?
No.
Okay, so the compliance piece for that is down here. So, that's why you'd want to fill out that area. Okay. So, I don't want to give you any legal advice on there, check with your broker, but for most, that's fine. And then you can also change the Keller Williams logo over there to be your Keller Williams Infinity if you want to do that.
You know how you've got LinkedIn and Facebook at the bottom?
Mm-hmm.
Mine's at the bottom, but mine's also at the top, very top line.
So I would just delete them. I'm not a big fan of that.
How do you?
You just take them out. You just take the links out of your social media, the social media section here.
So then we won't have them anywhere.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. Or choose.
There's
a theme
no way to eliminate it from the top.
Correct.
Okay. Got it.
All right. So earlier we talked about this SEO and setting up a C name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There is a section that says add a custom domain name to your site. Over on the right-hand side is all of the domain registrar's step-by-step instructions on how to do this. Whether you're with GoDaddy or Enom or whoever, they're all there. It's in the 5-minute video that I'm going to send you as well, but they're all there. So this is how you get your domain name set up so that you earn the SEO. And that's the C name. Okay? Those pieces are huge. Otherwise, you're giving all the credit to myrealestateplatform.com, which is the place to your domain, which we don't want to do.
Do you recommend in the domain it be the actual person's name or?
Wow, that's a really good question. And we could probably debate that for the next hour.
Because if they don't know who you are, they're not going to be searching for your name.
And that's going to be my exact answer to you.
Yeah.
Is that if you have an established real estate business that your face has been plastered all over signs and billboards and buses all over the place, roll with your name.
Mm-hmm.
If you're relatively new to an online kind of lead capture strategy, then go with something that's geographically based. Like I said earlier, nobody's looking for a realtor. They're looking for lifestyle properties. They're looking for information. So, you know, if you could get something like, you know, I told you earlier, the one client has I Love Hunter's Creek.
Okay.
If you could get I Love, Eva, are you ready for this?
Ashton.
Did you get it already?
Everybody's like, wait,
uh-huh.
No,
yeah.
Oh my God.
So, yeah, exactly. I spelled it totally wrong.
Just bought it.
So grab those kind of things, and that's how you should build your brand if you do not have your face plastered all over the place. So I can argue either way. Here's what I'm going to tell you. Everybody, if you've got a pen and paper, write this down for me. If you're typing, type this in. I would like for you to write down emailstationery.com. And not just because I own the company and I want you to buy some. How many people spelled stationery E-R-Y? And how many people spelled stationery A-R-Y?
You bought them both.
60% of Americans spell stationery wrong, and it is spelled E-R-Y. A little competition in here. Our first family reunion in 2007, we get to set up our booth in Atlanta. Or maybe it was 2008, 7 or 8, whatever it was in Atlanta. We get there to set up our booth. The sign says email stationery is spelled wrong. So I'm like, all right, no problem. Our booth's going to cover it anyway. I take the sign down. We put our booth up. And then 2 weeks, 3 weeks after family reunion, we're getting all these phone calls about your website is down. Your website is down. Your website is down. What are you talking about? In the program guide, they spelled email stationery wrong. And we did not own the A-R-Y version of the domain. Yeah, all we owned was E-R-Y, the correct spelling. So gentlemen in the Grand Caymans, $8,000 and 6 months later, we own emailstationary.com, the incorrect spelling of our domain. Yeah. So I totally botched up how to spell Ashbury, because there's probably six ways you can spell it.
Yeah.
If you can grab the misspellings, grab the misspellings. Okay? That goes for your name, that goes for any of the other domain names that you're purchasing, grab the misspellings. Susie, how do you spell Susie? Z-I-E-S-I-E, right? Grab the misspellings. If you cannot have the .com, do not buy it. Don't buy .net, .info, .realtor, .whatever. Your consumer's never going to remember that when you bump shopping carts at Jewel and they go home and type it in. They're going to type in the .com. And if that's your competitor, guess what you just did? Right? So if it's too good to be true and you can't have the .com, go fish. Try something else. There's still a lot of good domain names out there.
On the general info, where you're putting in your name and your office and all that, the meta title and description.
So that's for your home page. So it's the one that basically will be at the top of your home page. So in that case, I would put the area that you service, maybe Homes for Sale in Naperville or Homes for Sale in Ashbury by Eva.
As the title, and then description up down.
Yeah. Description, something really attractive that they would want to click on. It. Now, the chances of your home page being found in the Google search engine is very low, unless they were searching for your name or they were
right.
searching for that. So it doesn't have to be as kind of...
Doesn't it have to equal both? Doesn't it have to match your domain? Is the meta title?
No.
Oh,
it doesn't.
Okay.
It needs to be more human than your domain.
Okay.
Yeah. It needs to be more human.
What if it's your website name?
The meta title?
Uh-huh.
I wouldn't.
No.
It's an opportunity to talk like a person. So I would put spaces in there and I would talk more like a person. So for example, if you bought I Love Ashbury, I wouldn't put that as the page title or the meta title. I would put something like, you know, Ashbury is the best community in Naperville, and this is why you should like to live here, something along those lines. Those are all really good questions. The last thing that we're going to look at is lead capture. I told you in the pro site there was advanced lead capture. What you have in the basic is on or off. In the advanced, you have the option to say how you want to lead capture people. And you can do that in a number of ways. A number of times that the person comes to visit. So let's say, for example, they're on our website today. We'll let them search for 100, 200, 500 different pages. But if they come back tomorrow, I'm going to lead capture, right? Or they come back later on this afternoon, I'm going to want to lead capture. That would be after number of site visits. You could say, I'll let you look at as much as you want on my website, but after 10 minutes, I want your name, address, and phone. Okay, so that's number of minutes. Number of page views, pretty obvious how many pages they go to. Not listings, but pages. So if they were going through all 7,000 of your blogs, whenever they hit that, it would cause them to try and register. And then after a certain number of page views on a certain type of page, so maybe you want to let them view everything on your website, but when they get to the second area page, I want to lead capture, okay? So this gives you very finite and articulate control over when you ask the person to lead capture. And every demographic, every website, every community is different. So this is something that you have to test. And on e-agency, it's only on the lead capture pages or on the listing detail pages, not any of their pages. On Market Leader, it's, I think, two, right? After the second home they view, it forces lead capture. So So I'm not going to put my information in there on the second page. Most people are not going to put their information on the second page. Or I'll put Mickey Mouse in there on the second page. Yeah.
So the standard version is immediate?
Yeah, on or off.
We turn it on?
Yeah. So, now, the one thing I'll tell you, though, is that there is this checkbox that says, allow the contact form to be disabled. So, this doesn't have to be like, you must fill this out or I will not let you continue. It could just be, hey, fill this out, and there's a big X that they can click the box and exit away.
Sort of like an opt-out feature.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not the same.
Is that the advanced, though?
What's that?
Is that the advanced version? I think we only have the
This is the advanced, yes.
Yeah.
Yep. Otherwise, you have on or off.
So being on and off, what does it mean? On means they have to put their name in right away.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't get a choice as to how many all these
are. Don't do that on your website.
Yeah, I wouldn't. Yeah.
So, I'm sorry. Could you just kind of repeat the general rule of thumb for some of the custom leave capture settings?
Leave capture settings, general rules. I think there's so much free information out there that your website should be free as well.
Okay.
I think that you should build value in the other data, other than listings, the other content, all that kind of stuff, so that they would want to lead capture. I think forcing lead capture is going to give you Mickey Mouse at 123 Main Street.
Okay.
These new sites, the way they're designed, the way these new sites are designed, it kind of encourages people to lead capture. Which one were we looking at that had the
problem? So if you know it's passive and someone types in, they actually
are just, that's exactly what we want. That's a great point. If somebody, you could get a bunch of Mickey Mouse at 123 Main Streets and your phone's vibrating all day, which you're like, yay, I'm getting a lot of leads, but they're crap leads.
Mm-hmm.
Or if somebody really puts their contact information in there, they're a hot lead. Like, it's a legit lead. They're much more likely to close.
But how about a call to action? What I found is give them everything for free, but want to schedule an appointment or for more information.
Yeah, that's...
Now,
that's
those would be only two lead capture, I think, have any
value. Yeah, so that's going to my exact point. Thank you for that. This is the listing detail page. There, it is loaded with lead capture. Everywhere on the page, there's lead capture. First of all, here's your address. If I star this property, it's a lead capture. There's no way to save the property unless you...
Can you take that off?
Put it in there. What do you mean? I wouldn't want to.
Only if you star it.
If you star it. Like, I clicked on the star because I want to save this. This is my favorite.
So they can click on it a little bit more.
They
can still look at it without clicking.
Correct. So if I want to save this in my favorites, I need an account to have favorites is the idea there. As we go further down the page here, it says request showing. So now we've got more lead capture here. On the right-hand side, we've got save again. They can share it. This is a great place for social. They can share it to their friends because when their friends see it, it comes back to your website, right? There's some social lift or viral lift out of that, people coming back to your website. Get in touch in the lower right-hand corner. So there's lead capture all as you're scrolling up and down the property details page, okay? So you can't really customize the call to actions that are in there, but it's kind of already thought out for you as going down that they can engage with you on that. Okay. All right. So that's the advanced lead capture.
So the one that you just showed with the star, is that advanced?
No.
Okay.
No, that's included in your basic package. Okay. Because that was them pushing the button, right? They were engaging with that. A couple of these sites that I showed you, these are websites that we've gone in and what's called a refresh, where we can go in there and basically create a custom site inside of PlayStore. So we'll look like no other. Like the 141,000 websites, you're gonna either have a white top or a red top, and or maybe a blue top, five pictures, and that's it. We can go in and completely customize that for stronger call to actions and better stickiness. This third thing down the list. So we want people to stick. If you wanna set your business apart, this is what we can do. So obviously this woman loves purple. Maybe not your favorite, not necessarily my favorite. But as you go in here, you see how we've got call to actions and speaking to different people that come into our website. The search is still there if they want to do the general search, home value, real nice bio about her. She did include her social and testimonials. So this is an example of a website that we've gone in and refreshed, and I'll show you a few more of those.
How much does it cost for you to refresh my website?
I'm going
to
make you an offer you cannot refuse. Ken, I am going to make you an offer that you will not refuse. What's that?
We got the same baby.
That's right. I'm going to hook you up. Okay.
For what?
I'm gonna hook you up. What am I gonna, I'm not gonna tap the app, but I'm gonna hook you up.
I'm not gonna tap the app,
but I'm gonna hook you up. So you can see as I'm clicking through all of these, they're just completely different. And it depends on your business what call to actions we're gonna use. So basically what this includes is you have a one-on-one consultation with one of our designers where they're gonna learn about your business and kind of get an idea of what you do in your business. Then they go back and they customize a proof of what your website would look based on what you talked about. And then it's just a static image of what the website would look like. You work back and forth with them revising that until you say, yep, that's exactly what I want it to look like. And then we turn it into code that makes your website work. And what's great about this, you know, we were talking about earlier, as you go through these office websites, it's going to be the same site, the same site, the same site, the same site. If you refresh your website, they look, these are the templates. So this is what you'd see. You'd see a template, template. And then if you go into other refresh websites, it's something that's going to be really sticky. People are going to engage with that. They're going to see that it's something different after all the ones that they've looked through that looked exactly the same. More importantly, is it allows you to customize the call to actions on the homepage. And this is something if you're sitting down in a listing presentation and you pull your website up, this is where the sellers are going to go, okay, yeah, that makes sense. Wow, I do want to list with you. Because your website gives that professionalism and it looks different. Two Keller Williams agents go sit down at the same listing. One has a refresh one has a plain one. They're going to see a big difference. So website refresh, it's completely custom. So none of these look the same. Is a one-time fee. There are no recurring monthly or annual fees on that. It's $17.99. For the events like this, we do $14.99. It is our anniversary month.
$14.99, it's not $14.99.
No, because it's a lot of work. But because Ken is an advocate for you from the back of the room, and when I go out, I have to sell because I own the company. So if I go back with less orders than my sales reps, I look terrible. So we'll do them for $12.99. So I'll give you the order forms here. I'll pass some of those out. If you want to do that, the process takes a long time. It takes about a month, maybe 6 weeks to complete that because it is custom design work. So we do all of that work for you, and then we code it, do all the HTML coding to make your website actually work. And like I said, that's a one-time fee. You can just cross out the $14.99. I printed them before I got
it. And what is that really doing for that?
So you're basically getting a custom design theme for your Playster site. We'll also set up all of your coding, your CNAME. We'll transfer any content that you need to be transferred over from eAgency. It's essentially a custom design and then hands-off.
Where do you get the photos from if you wanted to use your own custom photos? Is that something that we would send to you?
If you have them, we're happy to use photos that you have licensed to. We have a stock photography site with tens of millions of web photos that we can direct you to choose some of your own if you'd like to do that. That's included in the cost, too, is the licensing of the photos.
Okay.
Yep. I bet your photos are pretty good.
Pardon me?
I bet your photos are pretty good.
Yes. All of the ones that I showed you were, this is a stock photography.
I'm not with your iPhone.
What's that?
I'm not taking with your iPhone.
I mean, it's getting pretty good on the iPhone. I'm recording this with the iPhone. It's getting good, but yeah. And definitely lots of Photoshop there, too. All right. Any questions for the group? I'm certainly going to sit back and answer any questions individually like we talked about earlier, but any questions for the group? Yes, sir?
I have one.
Sure.
Do I care how many people read my blog?
How many people read your blog? Do you care how many people read your blog? I don't care how many people read my blog.
Okay.
What I do care is the number of leads that I get from the people that are reading my blog. So if I wrote a blog article and it only got, you know, 5 people to read it, but all 5 people lead captured, I feel pretty good about that. If I wrote a blog and I had 5,000 people read it and only 5 people lead captured, I feel kind of dirty about that. So it really depends.
So the only way for them to actually read it is for it to come up in the SEO, right?
The only way for someone to read your blog, 2 ways. Yes, to come up in SEO, and that is most likely what's going
to
happen.
Or go to my site.
Very few people will go to your site and say, let me see what this guy blogs about. So more often than not, we encourage through the process, don't put your blog up there. It doesn't matter. If they're there, let them get to, you know, neighborhoods, listings, and that kind of stuff. So,
or Jack can post his blog posts from his website
on
Facebook.
Social. Yep.
And he's got 1,000 fans, let's say. That's going to drive traffic to his website.
Correct. Correct. Yep. Absolutely. Good question. Any other questions for the group?
If we need help with Playster, who do we talk to?
So part of that sign-up sheet, every Wednesday we kind of have an open call at 1 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Eastern. So you can log on our GoToWebinar, and you'll have not one-on-one, but it's kind of group support with our team. If you sign up for the refresh, you have our team Monday through Friday from 9 to 6. Or you can email support-kw at playster.com.
What was the time on Wednesdays?
1 p.m. Central. And I'll send you the link. Make sure your email address is on that sign-in sheet. I'll send you the link for that. It's every Wednesday at 1 p.m. And we typically have a topic for 10 or 15 minutes, maybe 20 minutes, and then afterwards it's just completely open Q&A.
Is that 1 p.m. Eastern?
No, it's 1 p.m. Central. It's 2 p.m. Eastern.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Where are you all
at? Orlando.
Yeah. You said that, my apologies.
No, that's okay. It's all good. If you're thinking about doing the refresh, just cross the $14.99 off, write $12.99 next to it. We take all credit cards. If you don't want to pay for it up front, you can do a PayPal buyer credit. It'll give you 6 months, no interest. You just apply at PayPal. The process does take a few weeks to get going. After MegaCamp, we are ridiculously busy. Has anybody done a refresh with us before? No one? That's great. We have about an 8 to 10 week backlog after MegaCamp and family reunion, so it's good timing if you're thinking about doing that now. Other than that, if there's nothing else for the group, I'll certainly hang back and answer any individual questions that you have. And then probably on Tuesday when I get back to Orlando, we'll load all that stuff in there and we'll send the videos and the links out for the webinars and the Q&A sessions. So, all right. Did you guys learn something today?
Sure.
Yes?
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it.